Good evening, dear colleague. Today I will speak about patellar tendinopathy treatment with patellar rich plasma ultrasound guided. Patellar tendinopathy is a chronic patellar tendinopathy turned to be a common and challenging tendon injury in physiatry, sport medicine, and orthopedic surgery. And it affects about 20% of elite athletes in basketball and volleyball, and sometimes can cause early retirement from the sporting activity, and it is challenging in its management. It can affect other non-elite athletes up to 8.5%. We are going to use platelet-rich plasma, which is an autologous derivative of a whole blood, a volume of plasma that have platelet count above the baseline, which is about average about 200,000 or more than 1 million or above 5 folds, and it is controversially. The benefit of a platelet-rich plasma that it contains high concentration of growth factors, including transforming growth factor B, insulin-like growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, basic fibroblast growth factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, as well as bioactive proteins that influence the healing of tendon and ligaments and muscle and bone. As a result, it has been studied for its efficacy in management of various pathologies, including but not limited to OA, lateral epicondylitis, rotator cuff disease, Achilles, and patellar tendinopathy, which is our topic today, hamstring injuries and degenerative spine disease. A lot of literature is growing evidence for the use of platelet-rich plasma, intratendinous injections of platelet-rich plasma, feasibility and effect on tendon morphology and mechanics. The intratendinous PRP injections are retained within the tendon and primarily distributed longitudinally. With minimal cross-sectional spread, intratendinous injection may alter tendon morphology and mechanics. And according to this basis, we will see in our videos of ultrasound-guided injection to the patellar tendon in the longitudinal axis to keep the PRP in the longitudinal axis for healing and resuming a normal physiological regenerative and healing process. Platelet-rich plasma in treatment of patellar tendinopathy. It is safe, promising therapy in treatment of recalcitrant patellar tendinopathy. Summary of studies using PRP patellar tendinopathy in Indian Journal of Orthopedic January 2014. Cumulative studies about different use of PRP in lateral epicondylitis, Achilles tendinitis, plantar fasciitis, patellar tendinopathy, rotator cuff tendinopathy. There are a huge accumulating evidence for using a platelet-rich plasma, although it is controversial due to the different concentration and preparation and controlling studies. Use of platelet-rich plasma for patellar tendon and medial collateral ligament, best current practice. From this paper, you can see that 7 of 11 studies applies 2 or 3 injections given the heterogeneity of PRP protocols and paucity of high-quality data. The most effective approach to guide clinical decisions regarding patellar tendinopathy cannot be deduced from presented published studies. So some studies are not agreeing about the evidence of PRP. Color Doppler ultrasound findings of patellar tendinopathy in jumper knee. About 2/3 of patients with jumper knee can be expected to have structural tendon changes in neovascularization. There was no relationship between changes in ultrasound characteristic and knee function after sclerosing treatment. Another study are multiple platelet-rich plasma injection useful for treatment of chronic patellar tendinopathy in athletes. In this study, the application of 3 consecutive ultrasound-guided PRP injections significantly improved symptoms and function in athletes with chronic patellar tendinopathy that allowed fast recovery to their pre-symptom sporting level. The PRP treatment permitted the return to a normal architecture of the tendon as assessed by MRI, and we will see that in our patients, the ecotexture of the tendon has resumed nearly normal ecotexture after using the PRP injections. Although in the another abstracts, despite all these studies, show benefits in utilization of high volume injection in the management of chronic recalcitrant tendinopathy. The available literature is scarce with only limited studies of suboptimal quality evidence. Another study, platelet-rich plasma for patellar tendinopathy, shows combined with an exercise-based rehabilitation program, a single injection of leukocyte-rich or leukocyte-poor PRP was no more effective than saline for improvement of patellar tendinopathy. So some studies show that there is equal between injection of a PRP and the normal saline disrupting the neovascularization at the plane between the Hoffa fat and patellar tendon. Synergicity of activity of platelet-rich plasma and high-volume image-guided injection in patellar tendinopathy. In this study, we compared using high-volume saline and comparing it with platelet-rich plasma and comparing it with the combined effect of platelet-rich plasma and high-volume saline injection. And they concluded that the combined administration of platelet-rich plasma and high-volume image-guided injections of saline treatments influence tendon repair by means of the diffuse mechanism, grants a greater improvement for patellar tendinopathy. These findings has a clinical relevance given this condition as substantial impact on sport and work performance. Another recent study in Egyptian Journal of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine, Zagaz University, from which I am graduated, it shows that high volume injection of saline and PRP are effective in treatment of patellar tendinopathy, not responding to conservative treatment. However, in our study, PRP proved to be more effective. In musculoskeletal medicine, current reviews is there is a cumulative current clinical recommendations for use of platelet-rich plasma. The summary is promising treatment for some musculoskeletal diseases. However, evidence of its efficacy has been highly variable depending on the specific indication. Additional high-quality clinical trials with longer follow-up will be critical in changing our perspective of this treatment option. So from this current clinical practice, we can conclude this. Abundant high quality evidence supports the use of low leukocyte rich PRP injections for lateral epicondylitis, a low leukocyte poor PRP for osteoarthritis. Yes, we can use it. A moderate of high quality evidence supports the use of leukocyte-rich PRP injections for patellar tendinopathy and of PRP injection for plantar fasciitis, donor site pain, and patellar tendon graft, ACL reconstruction. We can use it. There is insufficient evidence to routinely recommend PRP for rotator cuff tendinopathy or a hip high ankle sprains, while current evidence demonstrates lack of efficacy of PRP for Achilles tendinopathy, muscle injuries, acute fracture or non-union, surgical augmentation, rotator cuff repair, Achilles tendon repair, and ACL reconstruction. From the anatomy and MRI, we know that the anterior fibers coming from the rectus femoris is continuously anteriorly to the patella. The patella is the largest sesamoid bone, while the patellar ligaments, anterior fibers, are a continuation from the anterior fiber of the quadriceps tendon as the extensor mechanism, while the middle and posterior fibers are at the attachment flow from the lower pole of the patella. This is a normal ultrasound of a patellar tendons, the tibial tuberosity, the patellar tendons, the attachment at the lower pole. We can see it is a smooth, homogeneous fibrillar echo pattern. Our case, it is 23 years old volleyball player, anterior inferior proximal patellar knee pain since 2015. His MRI patellar tendinopathy since 2015, jumper knee. He had the different treatment protocols, extracorporeal shock with therapy, laser, prolo, dry needling, plus rehab protocols including eccentric proprioceptive training with limited benefit in pain and function. And he stopped his sport activities as a volleyball elite athlete 8 months back, and he was referred to KUWAIT PMR musculoskeletal ultrasound intervention unit. His VISA score was 28. A musculoskeletal ultrasound shows severe tendinopathy with Hoffitis with excessive neovascularization both proximal patellar tendon and Hoffa fat bed. Our treatment was 2 sessions, 2 weeks apart, 4cc PRP, Dr. PRP USA, ultrasound-guided injections into proximal insertion of patellar tendon in plane long axis from distal to proximal 2cc between the Hoffa fat bed plane and the patellar tendon. And the other 2cc was intratendinous in the long axis at two different layers. The results after 3 months, his VISA score raised to 65, and he started his graded exercise and was very satisfied. After 6 months, the VISA score raised to 88, and the patient resumes his sport activity at a moderate level. We use the VISA score, which is include eight questions, including pain and different types of function tests. The maximum score, which is normal, is 100, and the supposed minimum score is 0. So this is our preparation for PRP after aspiration of the withdrawal of the blood and separation by Dr. PRP centrifuge. We have this puffy layer, which is the highly concentrated PRP, about 2.5 million milliliter. So we'll take 4 millimeter and we'll inject it to the patellar tendon. This is a normal panoramic view of the patellar tendon, a smooth attachment to the patella, and we can see the normal fibrillar ecotexture. And this is a normal X-ray with a smooth lower pool of the patella. This is the patella of the patient. We can see prominent distal osteophyte from the lower pool of the patella, and we can see here the osteophyte with the fragmentation, swelling, and edema of the tendon, and a partial hypoechoic tear of the posterior fibers of the patellar tendon at the proximal attachment. And this is a MRI of the patient. We can see the signal changes, the swelling, and we see the traction osteophytes at T1 and T2, and we can see the panoramic view. It is similar to the, it is nearly similar to the MRI. So showing the tendinopathy changes, edema, and in the power Doppler, definitely you'll see the vascularity is in the posterior aspect of the patellar tendon and in the Hoffa fat bed. So the vascularization is involving the Hoffa fat bed and the patellar tendon. This is why we should target not only the patellar tendon, but we should target the Hoffa fat bed. So this is a video showing the patellar tendon, and we'll show that our needle is coming from this side, and it should be in long axis of the tendon, reaches the pathological site. Then we will separate the plane between to disrupt the neovascularization in the Hoffa fat bed with 2cc. Then while withdrawing our needle, we'll go slowly and we'll inject intratendinous in the long axis plane, and we can see the different planes. First is the separation of the plane between the patellar tendon and the Hoffa fat bed. Then our needle will be withdrawn and we'll start to inject at this level. Again, we'll withdraw the needle and we'll start to inject at another level. So we inject 2 cc of platelet-rich plasma in the patellar tendon itself, the proximal pathological lesion, and this is the aim of accuracy and the nice use of our ultrasound machine to guide our needle and to install our medication exactly inside the site of the lesion. This is the patient ultrasound 6 months after injection of the PRP. We can see nearly resuming of the normal ecotexture and decreasing of the thickness of the patellar tendon, returning to its normal thickness, and in the power doubling indices, the marked reduction in the vascularization, and this is evidence-based using the ultrasound to monitor our rehab program and our injection protocol. So this is 6 months after the giving 2 sessions of PRP, and the patient have resumed his activity after 6 months. He started his gradual exercise and rehab program, specific rehab program for his sport at 3 months, and resume his sport after 6 months. We can see here before using the PRP treatment, the swollen tendon while he is a normal patellar tendon. You can see here the tip traction osteophyte. You can see the power Doppler signal before and after the treatment. So the result of 2 sessions of 2 weeks apart, 4cc PRP, ultrasound-guided injection into the proximal insertion of the patellar tendon in plain long axis from distal to proximal, 2cc between Hoffa fat bed and patellar tendon, and 2cc intratendinous. After 3 months, his visa score raised to 65, and after 6 months, it raised to 88, and the patient resumed his sport activity. This is a brief of the visa score. Thank you.